Good afternoon, members. It is the scheduled time and the quorum is present. I call to order the meeting. Today, we will make use of the request to speak system. So after you have been seated, please do not change your seat. Item 1, information paper issued since the meeting on the 12th of July 2022. The relevant papers have been listed on the agenda. Concerning the legislative proposal, legislative amendment proposal on streamlining statutory procedures in relation to development and the public hearing, we have scheduled a special meeting on the 26th of April this year to take public submission on the legislative amendment proposal on streamlining statutory procedures in relation to development. In view of the development of the COVID-19, I decided to postpone the meeting and directed the secretariat to collect written submission. 29 written submissions have been received. The administration's consolidated response to the submission have been sent out to members. The paper's number is CB1652/2022-01. According to the updated 2022 legislative agenda submitted by the administration, the relevant bill, that is development, town planning, land and work, miscellaneous amendments bill, will be introduced into LegCo for scrutiny in the fourth quarter this year. I believe that a bills committee will be established to scrutinize the bill. I will request the bills committee to hold a public hearing subject to the epidemic situation. I propose that the panel need not call another public hearing on the matter. Is it agreeable with members? If there is no objection, then we will proceed according to my proposal. Thank you. Item 2, agenda item for the next meeting. There are only 2 regular meetings left for this legislative session. In November, the meeting is scheduled at 2:30 p.m. on Tuesday, 22nd of November. The date of the December meeting is yet to be scheduled. The Secretariat will notify members in due course. Now, for the next regular meeting dated the 22nd of November, four agenda items have been proposed. First, proposal on development of multi-story industrial buildings. It has been close to member hearts for some time. And then proposed creation of a supernumerary directorate post of AO's staff grade C in the Development Bureau. And then proposed measures to update and streamline the compulsory sale regime, that is in relation to the compulsory sale threshold. Fourth, proposed the free work in relation to the improvement of Yunlong Town and Nola Town Center Session, improvement work on the drainage works at Yunlong, and also the Yunlong Barrage Scheme. Do members agree with the above proposed agenda items? If there is no objection, then we would notify the administration of the agreed agenda items for the administration's preparation. Thank you. Item 3, briefing by the Secretary for Development on the Chief Executive's 2022 policy address. May I invite the administration to come in? Members who would like to speak may press the request to speak button now. I welcome the government representatives. This is a new arrangement because of the sheer number of officials at present. They will be seated on both sides of the meeting room. Now, I will read out the names of members who have raised their hands, and then I would defer. I would give the floor to the Secretary for Development. Mr. Tommy Cheung, Mr. Edward Lau, Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, Mr. Chen Hock Fong, Kenneth Lau, Mr. Vincent Zhang, Dr. Dennis Lam, Mr. Michael Tian, Ms. Carmen Kan, Mr. Frankie Yeek, and other members. Ms. Benedict Lin, Secretary for Development, ready when you are. Thank you very much, Chairman. Since the delivery of the policy address, we have been doing explanatory work to the media. I shall be brief today in my presentation to allow more time for members to ask questions. Now, the guiding principles of our efforts, that is the four enhancings. In land creation, besides supplying land for housing development, it is also important to our future development as well as improving Hong Kong people's living condition. On enhancing quantity, we have a very important measures. That is, for the first time, the government would publicize the 10-year forecast of developable land supply. We also pledge to update the forecast every year. So the table you see on the PowerPoint, it is also Annex D of the paper. Now we would always tell the public the quantity of land we have identified. But this time we are talking about land creation. This is about the quantity of farmed land or spade-ready land made available in the 10 years. So for the next 10 years, there will be some 3,280 hectares spade-ready sites available from the two engines. One of them is the Northern Metropolis. 3,000 hectares will come from the Northern Metropolis in the next 10 years, accounting to 40% of the total land supply in the Northern Metropolis. And some 300 hectares will come from the reclamation project as the KYC, a artificial island. The reclamation size is some 1,000 hectares in size. As a result, some 30% of the land created at the artificial island would be available in the next 10 years. All 3,280 hectares will be supplied from the government's land creation projects, including reclamation, land development, and also land development on government's land, and also land resumed from private owners. So some 500 hectares will be created by land resumption. 90% will come from the Northern Metropolis. Since this is such a massive development engine, what about the timetable of development? So some of the projects have commenced already. After funding approval by electrical, Kudong North, Fanlang North, and Yulong South projects have commenced. Now, for the other projects which are yet to be commenced, study is ongoing. We are looking to commence these projects as the second half of 2023 and early 2024, and then our development proposals would be ready. In terms of the institutional framework, because of the sheer size and the importance of the development engine, a steering committee and an advisory committee will be established later this year, and debate and discussion will begin. There will also be a dedicated department on the development of Northern Metropolis under the Development Bureau for supporting the steering committee, advisory committee, and also for coordinating the efforts between bureaus and departments. So next year, we will submit proposals to the LegCo for creation of new directorate posts for leading the departments. We will also engage in internal redeployment of manpower. So next year, the proposals will be, members will be consulted about the proposals. Now, in the near future, that is next year, there will be multi-story industrial buildings developed in the Northern Metropolis. So next month, we will consult the panel and brief members on how the approving procedures and also the how it works. Now for INT land at the Lok Ma Chau River Loop, there are facilities being built as we speak. As the Sha Tin Technical Poll, we hope that by year 2024, site formation work can commence. So next year is a critical time. We won't wait until the site formation work is completed before we negotiate with businesses. We will begin attracting businesses right away. So we will work together with the RTIB on this front. Another major engine is the 1,000 hectare land created under the KYC Artificial Island Project. So at the next meeting, we will brief members on the progress of the study. We will brief members on the reclamation size, and the major parameters, the major routes and railways alignments, and also the funding arrangement. Now the reclamation work for KYC Artificial Islands will have its EIA procedures conducted next year, and then in year 2025, we will begin reclamation. Now, this is an enhanced speed. For the Tung Chung extension project, it took 6 years from study to completion. Now, for the KYC artificial islands, it only requires 4.5 years from study to commencement. And also, we shall introduce bills to streamline development procedures later this year. So we will, under the bill, we will waive the requirements to have the land use planning available before reclamation, because it would stall our progress.
Another key area covered by the policy address is the Green Belt Review. Half of the green belts are on slopes that are too steep, or they are in catchment areas, making them unsuitable for development. But this time, we have identified around 255 hectares of land with the potential for providing up to 70,000 housing units. We already have 1,200 hectares or so greenbelt sites for various development projects. So this 255 hectares are on top of the 1,200 I just mentioned. For the 255 hectares of land, that there will be detailed engineering studies. I want to stress that for these green belts, to turn them into spade-ready sites, these are included in part of the 10-year forecast in terms of spade-ready sites. We want to streamline the process so that by 2024, we can start rezoning the first batch of the sites among these 255 hectares, so that within 10 years, we can turn all of them into spade-ready sites. Another project covered by the policy address is the Chuan Kwan O Area 137. There are roughly 80 hectares of land involved. There's a restriction on development, and that's chiefly about transportation. As the Secretary for Transport and Logistics has mentioned, there will be six new links involving rail links and highways. One of the rail links will be the Chuan Kwan O Line extension leading all the way to Area 137. There will also be the Chuan Kwan O Yao Tong Tunnel. With these two transportation links, the conditions will be right to take forward the development of Chuan Kwan O Area 137. We also want to take this opportunity to explore the possibility of near-shore reclamation near Area 137. We're not looking at high-density development. That kind of development will happen in Area 137. For near-shore reclamation, we want to provide community facilities, open space, for example. The extension of the Chuan Kwan O line, we also need land to sit on. So that will be something for the near-shore reclamation. Our goal is that by the end of this year, we can make an announcement and consult the public regarding the uses of the land so that by 2025, that works can start. And by 2030, we can have the first batch of population intake. Another project related to railways, this was covered by the policy address last year. That has to do with the Science Park in Park Shek Kok. The plan is about having a new MTR station there so that we can have better transportation and release the development potential of the land there. We have commissioned the MTR Corporation to commission a preliminary study. Based on how things are going so far, we know that it's technically feasible to have an MTR station in that area. But as for the specific sites for development and the specific kind of housing development, these points, we have to wait till the MTR Corporation completes a preliminary study, and then we will make an announcement and take follow-up actions. Moving on. Now, we also want to enhance the speed of development project. To achieve that, we will have to streamline our procedures. For each department, they are under stress to speed things up and enhance the quantity of what they deliver. So for the Development Bureau, we have to look at our workflow, our day-to-day workflow. By the end of this year, we will submit legislative amendment proposals to the LegCo. In parallel, we will also review our administrative procedures. This is the second round of review of our administrative procedures. There was an earlier round. These points have been outlined in the policy address, such as arrangements regarding underground car parks. Can we give more floor area to at-grade car parks instead of having them underground? Can the sector have their own certification and self-inspection arrangements? These are things we're looking at. And then there is also the point about the charging of land premium. If we can get these things to work, then that will help speed things up. So that by the middle of 2023, we can have an extension of these charging of land premium to possibly the agricultural land in the new territories. How many areas will there be, and how do we arrive at a standard rate if indeed we proceed with a standardization of the rate for land premium? Those details will be announced in due course. Now, in terms of enhancing the speed and quality of our deliverables, we have to promote the use of the modular integrated construction, or MIC. The concept behind our policy address is that we're not just encouraging the use of this method in one particular project. We need a whole policy to promote the use of this method in the entire industry. So that for the northern metropolis, we need a production base, a storage for space for the modules. We also need quality assurance. That is, we need a regime, we need a mechanism to ensure the quality. The Development Bureau will set up a cross-departmental steering committee to oversee such matters so that next year we can have a whole set of measures rolled out. Now I'm turning to a part that's relevant to everyone in the city. The land we're living on is subject to a land lease in one way or another. From 2025 onwards, there will be land leases that are due to expire. And by June 30th, 2047, there will be more land leases that will expire. I'm sorry, Secretary, we have to stop at 4:30 today without meeting. And many members wish to speak, so if you could. So we want to streamline the procedures instead of making a change to our policy on renewal. We will submit a bill next year regarding this arrangement. As for the enhancing of quality, I will cover that when I take questions in a moment. But this has to do with enhancing our compulsory sale application threshold so that we can redevelop the old dilapidated buildings. At the panel meeting next month, we will discuss this matter in greater detail. Now, I will skip this part about the borrowing limit of the Urban Renewal Authority. Around the island trail, the community wants to see us deliver good results. We want to connect 90% of the trail within 5 years. I will stop here, Chair. Thank you, Secretary. Before I invite members to speak, Secretary, please note that there will be four items on the agenda for the next meeting. So if you could provide us with the relevant papers quickly, that would be great. This time around, the papers arrived shortly before the meeting. So if you could do better next time, that would be great. I will now invite members to speak, 4 minutes for each member. Now let's be mindful of the time since we cannot extend the meeting this time. There was a different meeting after our session. We'll start with Mr. Tommy Cheung. Thank you, Chair. Secretary mentioned enhancing speed, quality, efficiency, and quality. Now, for us, the Liberal Party, we're happy to see that you have some concrete to offer. At the last term government, the Liberal Party indicated its support for development on greenbelt sites. My question has to do with the ratio of public and private housing. The ratio is 70 to 30. Over the past couple of years, Secretary, do you see a lackluster response to the scheme? The chief executive announced that raised the possibility of having a 60 to 40, that is 60% to public housing and 40 to private housing. It's better to have more land and you have a given ratio. My question about enhancing efficiency, you have left out the town planning board in the process. I'm pleased to see that the chief executive announced a target to shorten the time it takes for primitive sites to spade-ready land. Now the chief executive has announced a goal. But there's no mention of the role of the town planning board. I'm not saying there's a major flaw with the town planning board. I know the TPB is overworked. It has a lot of work. There's so much procedure. Many people are involved. So efficiency suffers. Have you considered anything regarding a TPB, or have you not even started considering what can be done about the TPB? I believe Mr. Tommy Chen was referring to the land sharing pilot scheme. Now we have received 5 applications under the scheme. The housing units that can be supported are in a large number. We're talking about somewhere over 25,000 housing units. We also have some prospective applications. A dedicated office of the Development Bureau is in touch with the relevant parties. Our assessment is that the 70-30 ratio of public to private housing has not deterred property developers from coming to us. For some of their applications we have received, they can already start going through the EXCO and the town planning procedure. Now, in terms of streamlining our procedures, does that cover the town planning board? Now, of course, it will be part of the process. In terms of the statutory procedures involving the TPB, if you go by the law, it says that the statutory procedure would take 17 months from commencing a study to turning the site into a spade-ready site. The town planning board takes up a small portion of the process. When we say it used to take 17 years or 6 years to turn a primitive site into the spade-ready site, that time involved many other things as well, environmental impact assessment, for example. But what about the changes to the town planning process? We will shorten. That means a shorter statutory period will be written into the law. And if we receive a large number of submissions during a process, we would like the people submitting the submissions to attend the town planning board meetings in person instead of sending a proxy there. Otherwise, you get a protracted process. And we don't want to see people who are not landowners to submit applications for rezoning. Next, Mr. Edward Lau. Thank you, Chair. I thank the Secretary for taking on board DAB's comments on land development, including exploring the use of greenbelt site and streamlining procedures. In terms of enhancing speed and quantity, you're showing us direction and there is hope for people. You're being ambitious with your targets, but can you actually deliver? That's something I want to find out. In terms of land supply, now the government's saying you want to take back control. To retake control of land supply, what's the target the government has in mind in terms of a land reserve? Is there any target in terms of developing land? We have only developed a quarter of our land. So come a development project, we have to retake land that is already used for something else and justify the move with an urgent goal, say housing. Is there anything in your plans about developing more land? For greenbelt sites, the government's plan is to look at the 255 hectares of greenbelt sites by 2024. That is conservative. Even if you exclude the 8,000 hectares of greenbelt sites that are ecologically important, meaning they are not suitable for development, you still have another 8,000 hectares. And when you subtract all those, you still have more than 6,000, that is more than 6,200 hectares of greenbelt sites with potential for development. Does the government have a timetable for developing the more than 6,000 hectares of greenbelt sites? And I have a second question. It also has to do with enhancing speed. The government's goal is that within 10 years, you want to complete 40% of the flats at places like Kutong North, Hongshoukiu, and Fanning North. Now, have you, is that a timetable arrived at after taking into account the streamlined procedures? If that is the case, it would be too conservative. By 2030, you will have to have the population intake in northern new territories. In 2037 and 38, those would be the years for intake for Hongshoukiu. So I don't see an increase in speed, so I want to find out more from the Secretary.
Secretary, please. Yes, Chair. In terms of taking back control and also the question on land reserve, the government is taking initiative in terms of land creation. We are not trying to compete with the private sector. It's not that whoever has more land can have control. Sometimes when you have a lot of land, if they are not developable and they are without potential, then you don't have control. So by taking back control, it is to allow the public to see that the government is taking a holistic approach to take initiative to roll out different programs to supply land on a continuous basis. Sometimes the public would question whether the government still had some land reserve. So this is our pledge. We will let the public see that the government is very proactive in terms of supplying land. Now, concerning the remaining 6,000 hectares of greenbelt sites mentioned by Mr. Lau, we expect to complete the review for the remaining land next year. For those, well, there may be very few sites with high-density development potential. Otherwise, they would be included in this batch. Now, we are trying to identify sites which may not be suitable for high-density development, but there are other possible uses for them. At South Lantau, we have more than 1,000-hectare greenbelt site. Despite the concept of a conservation for the South, the 1,000-hectare large site can still be used for rural tourism and ecotourism purposes. The Sustainable Lantau Office will take forward the work in this regard. Now, for the 3,200-hectare large size to be made available in the next few years, we have to rely on the streamlined procedures. So I urge members and the industry to support our bill as well as our other measures to remove barriers. Dr. Low Wai Kwok.
Thank you, Chair.
This policy address has dedicated much content to land creation and housing supply on earnestly addressing the difficulties of livelihood. It also pointed out that a land supply and housing supply is very important. I do agree with the CE's strategic goals. That is, we have to compress the land creation processes and we have to compress the timetable for turning a primitive site into spade-ready site, enhance a public-private partnership, enhancing speed, and build up land reserve on a continual basis. Now, for the past 25 years, I have criticized the government many times on its deficiencies in terms of land supply and housing creation. It's just a matter of will and resolution. it seems that the public is very pleased to hear these measures announced in the PA. Well, in order to achieve enhanced quality, speed, efficiency, and quality, there are many challenges ahead. Over the past 25 years, there have been so much lackings and so much not being done. So I support the government's determination. At the same time, I'm also worried because it will require tremendous resources and manpower. So in terms of land creation, transport, support, and so on, it takes many people and a lot of resources to achieve your vision. Now, I know there is a chapter in the PA on increasing manpower supply, but I'm really worried whether it can dovetail the aggressive timetable of land creation. So I would like to listen to the Secretary for some assurances. Now, the CE said the market force would be utilized by harnessing a public-private partnership. I think this is the right mindset. For the past two decades, the government always shied away from collaborating with the private sector because for fear of colluding with businesses. But we should really harness the power of the private market. So I would like to hear more on this from the Secretary. Yes, indeed there are many challenges ahead on the demand for manpower. In the next few years, the number of public and private projects will be on the upward trend. A few years later, we will be talking about more than $300 billion spent on works per year. So now we are updating our forecast on manpower demand in terms of professionals, engineers, and also frontline workers. So by the end of this year, when the forecast is prepared, the Development Bureau will look at the report. Besides importing labor and increasing manpower supply, we will also try to meet up for the demand by utilizing INT measures coupled with measures to increase labor. So by the end of this year, there will be a clearer picture available. In terms of public-private partnership, I always shared the same ideology with Dr. Low. I never considered public-private collaboration collusion. It is something that happens under the table. For public-private partnership, it is out in the open and there is no collusion at all. We have the land sharing pilot scheme, and even for projects initiated by the government as the NDA, we would also offer the we would also work with the private sector in terms of development. Now we are trying to harness the power from private land owners if they have the capacity to help us. So we are trying to bring on board private developers and the private sector in terms of development, and also we will lower the application threshold for compulsory sale. So this is how we harness the market force. Mr. Chen Hongfeng, I think the land development strategies under the PA are very pragmatic and very aggressive. I can really see that the government has put its heart into it, especially for KYC at the Fisher Island. The timetable is clear. A plan would be available this year, and next year there would be EIA, and year 2025 reclamation will begin. Well, but I don't see the 2025 KPI on the policy address. Is the government not confident that reclamation can begin by year 2025? Since you have promised us the timetable, why don't you write it into the KPI on the PA? Now, for the Round the Island Trail, we are all behind it. With the Round Island Trail, the public can enjoy the beautiful sights along the promenade. So under your design, the trail is only for pedestrians, but we also want cyclists to be able to enjoy the Round the Island Trail. So can you also promise to provide cycling tracks for cyclists? Now, under the enhanced speed and efficiency principles, you would lower the application threshold for compulsory sale for all the districts. Now, for adjoining sites, land entitlement, and also the threshold can be considered under a consolidated manner. I know you want to enhance speed and efficiency, but you have to care for the welfare of individual owners. Individual owners would be called in between the development. So I hope the government would also pay attention to the smaller owners. Now, the 2025 reclamation timetable of KYC at the Fisher Island is not written into the KPI. The member has a very sharp eye. Actually, the time frame has been written into the indicators at the back of the PA. So I thank you for your suggestion. We will make it clearer the next time around. Concerning the Round the Island Trail, for the northern part of the island, there are more space, and we can offer cyclist tracks together with a footpath for the northern part. For other parts, however, the terrain is deeper and the roads are narrower, so it is more difficult for us to offer cycling tracks along with the footpaths. But we will try to meet the aspiration of the public as best as we can. Now, for the threshold for compulsory sale, we do have special consideration for adjoining lots. So it is written clearly in the law that the two lots must be connected with a staircase for it to be eligible for that consideration. But it is not very common. It is not a very common scenario. So our design is that even if the lots are allowed to is eligible for a combined consideration, the final threshold cannot be lower than the statutory threshold. So the existing threshold, minimum threshold, is 60%. So we can assure you that the threshold would not be lower than that. So next time around, we can have a more in-depth discussion on this. Next, Mr. Kenneth Lau. Thank you, Chair. Now, the PA has given us the 10-year forecast of land creation, and there will be more than 3,280 hectares of spare-ready sites, no less than 1,300 from the northern metropolis, and 300 hectares will be from the KYC reclamation project. So the government will enhance speed and efficiency and drastically streamline and compress the timetable by streamlining administrative and statutory procedures. more sites will be identified to create land reserve, including the new round of study on greenbelt sites and also agricultural lands. I'm in full support of that. Now, the government expects to resume a 500-hectare site in the next 5 years. 90% will be from the northern metropolis. As the second half of next year, at the soonest, the northern metropolis strategy would be announced. Now, it is a vast piece of land, and the government has encountered many challenges in its land resumption efforts in the past. So how will the government overcome these obstacles, and how will the government avoid a conflict between the administration and the people?
Chair, the plan is to resume 500 hectares of land in the years to come. For each resumption exercise, there is a development project, so we do have timetables. Now, as to the concern about resistance to resumptions. Now, if I take a detached view, the kind of resistance we've had over the past few years is much less than what we had had further back in the past, with support from the community and the LegCo starting from 2018. We have improved the compensation arrangements for squatter settlements. Over the past few months, we have improved compensation proposals. For brownfield operators, we have relaxed some of the rules. We have worked with our stakeholders to improve our proposals so that when resumption starts and clearance comes around, things have been proceeding more smoothly. For certain brownfield operators or proprietors, they are worried about resumption. But then after communication, things changed. Message that the compensation proposals have been improved haven't always got to the party affected. So we have to reach out to the people affected one by one. We have to knock on every door and approach each individual operator. And this is a labor-intensive process. To help the brownfield operators, we also have to compile more information so that they can find another spot to relocate their operation. We are learning as we proceed with such exercises. Some cases are illuminating. That is, when we make small changes, that may turn out to make huge differences. Next, Mr. Vincent Cheng. Thank you, Chair. My questions have to do with urban renewal. I have to declare my interest. That is, I am a non-executive director of the Urban Renewal Authority. Now, under the policy address, there is a proposal about raising the borrowing limit of the URA. I want to see the URA play a larger role and expedite redevelopment projects in Yao Qin Wong and Mong Kok, as well as the Sham Shui Po projects. The URA is involved. Will there be a KPI applicable to urban redevelopment projects so that we get a sense of the number of units we can produce within a certain time frame? Are there mid-term or long-term goals? Now, there is also a proposal about adjusting the compulsory sale thresholds, but this will depend on whether the bill is passed. Now, but some residents have expressed concerns. Will they be evicted? Will they be left in a position with no bargaining power? Is there anything the government has to help the minority owners so that assistance can be made available to them? The third point, my third point has to do with around the island trail. I have been trying to get more jogging paths or trails, not just for Hong Kong Island, but also for Kowloon. Once you link up different paths, you can have a healthy city. And I hope and want to see this turn into reality in the future. Over to the secretary. I thank the member for his support for the Round the Island Trail. We will take forward the work in phases. In Kowloon, different sections of the harbor promenades will be connected. Now, turning to the point about a KPI for urban renewal. The proposal is about raising the borrowing limit for the URA. This is also an opportunity to do something else. Now, when they have more resources at hand, what more can they do? This will be something we will follow up with the URA. Now, turning to compulsory sale. When that happens, what kind of support do we have for minority owners? One key area for us is to provide greater support. So we will set up a dedicated office. This office will be under the land registry. The office will provide several kinds of services. If there is a compulsory sale application, the owners may be on tenterhooks. So this office will provide valuation services so that the minority owners can decide for themselves based on the information to see whether they should litigate a matter or accept the offer. And if a matter does go to a lands tribunal, the minority owners will have to pay for their own lawyers and other professionals. But if we do have this office in the future, the office can pay the costs up front, and then the litigation ends. The court usually orders that the costs to be covered for the minority owners. So that's when the costs can be recovered. Now, turning to the point when the minority owners have to move and they run into difficulties in terms of moving, we can provide information for these minority owners. We understand that these minority owners may be seniors. They may need help in terms of access to information. But these are our directions for the time being. Many members are concerned about the Round the Island Trail. The impression we get is that this is just about the Hong Kong Island. What about Kowloon? I'm sure we have put forward the views, and the Harbourfront Commission has also noted the comment. The government departments, the relevant departments, should take this seriously. Show us that you are not just focusing on Hong Kong Island with concrete results. Next, Dr. Dennis Lam. Secretary, the policy address mentioned identifying sites. I do see a resolve to change things. Now, there's this goal about providing 3,280 hectares of speed-ready sites. This exceeds the target set out in 2030 plus vision. That is the demand of 3,000 hectares of land. The proposal is also about enhancing speed, quantity, efficient, and quality. I applaud the policy address for this point, but I want to see follow-up action so that the targets are met on time. My first question has to do with the preparation time for Kao Yi Chao reclamation. Secretary, you mentioned the goal being shortening the time it takes from 6 years to 4.5 years. But would you be looking into further compressing a time frame so that the time it takes will be 4 years? So instead of cutting down the time by a quarter, you can cut down the time by a third. If that can be done, many people will support you. My second question has to do with urban renewal. The older a building, the lower the threshold will be. That is the point of the lowering the application threshold. I support this proposal because this will speed up the urban renewal process. Apart from this step, has the government looked into other ways to, say, provide incentives for redevelopment? Say, a transfer of plot ratios so the developer can purchase several abutting land lots and combine the plot ratios. The Secretary, you just touched on some parts of my question, but I want to see you explore further these possibilities so that the sticking points can be looked at and the solution can be found. In terms of purchasing old buildings, minority owners sometimes find their offer price unreasonable, so they turn down an offer. Now, will the authorities learn from the URA or hire third-party valuation professionals in setting a price so that you can have a balance between the interests of the developers and the owners? For the Cao Yi Chao reclamation project, they were trying to reclaim 1,000 hectares of land. My colleagues in the works branch are already working on a very compressed timetable. It's just 4 years or so going all the way from a study to the reclamation. In the next 10 years, if we want to have 300 hectares of land reclaimed and turned into spade-ready sites, getting all that done in 7 years, that's no mean feat. It's unlikely that we can further compress the time that it would take. To meet the timetable I just mentioned, now we will have to get everything right in terms of legislative amendments and reviewing our administrative measures. All these will require your support. As for urban redevelopment, now, can we transfer plot ratios to expedite the process? It's a complex process. We will start with the Yao Tsim Wong area. We're trying to come up with ways in terms of guidelines with the URA and the planning department and try things out in Yao Tsim Wong. As for compulsory sale, would there be third-party valuation professionals engaged in the process? At land tribunals, when you have a case, the litigants will have to hire their own professionals in terms of valuation. But our plan is that in the future, we want to be able to provide information on valuation. And in this regard, third-party valuation professionals may be engaged. Now, this is an important point for minority owners. They may run into things they don't quite understand as far as valuation is concerned. So if the dedicated unit you have in mind can help them, that would be great. Next, Mr. Michael Tin. Thank you, Chair. Secretary, the last term government had this land supply debate thing involving nearshore reclamation. At Sunny Bay, for example, before the debate over land supply, your bureau came to me for comments. There were noise issues that makes the area uninhabitable. So the proposal was to turn the site into something for recreational purposes. But then the government entered into an agreement with Disneyland so you couldn't have other recreational facilities nearby. So then I proposed having a race course for car racing. Ever since we've had Disneyland constructed in 2012, we haven't had any new project. 20 years, we're still relying on old things, Disneyland. Recently, Singapore has held an F1 event, 300,000 spectators. There were also tourists, so you can imagine what all the economic benefits from the fully booked hotels. 4 or 5 years have elapsed. Not much progress has been made. This year, aside from the Maliu Shui project, other proposals have been left out. Now, I believe it's a problem of priorities instead of a proposal falling by the wayside. Now, people are all talking about land for housing, but then the chief executive mentioned reviving the economy and having new industries. The Commerce and Economic Development Bureau and the Culture, Sports and Tourism Bureau also have to do something here. Now, the excuse I've had is that you lack flour and you cannot have and you cannot do any bakery without flour. All these development projects easily take up 5, 8 to 10 years. So do all the proposals brought up at the previous administration get forgotten at the current term government? If you leave these proposals out, how can you assure me that your proposals today will turn into reality? I hope I can get a response from the Secretary.
Secretary, thank you, Chair. First of all, I agree with Michael Tian. We haven't mentioned the reclamation project at Sunny Bay in the policy address. That's just an issue of priority. It is not that we have abandoned the project. Now, the reclamation project has constraints, including building height because of its proximity to the airport, and also other constraints. The original plan was for recreational and tourism uses. It did have lower priority. As a result, it is not mentioned in the PA this time. So we have a plan to reactivate the project. So we are the bureau responsible for supplying the ingredients to make the cake. We need to have someone leading the project on ongoing reclamation projects and reclamation projects down the pipeline. So the manpower situation is very tight, but we will reactivate the project in due course. So who should I chase after? Should I chase after the one who made the ingredients or the one who made the cake? Now you are chasing after me, the one who made the ingredients, and I will take up your concern to the one who made the cake. Thank you. So I think Mr. Michael Tian's concern is valid. Developable land created from reclamation and otherwise are not just for housing development. We're talking about diversifying our economy, so we need to have a balanced economy. So there has to be internal coordination among the government departments. Ms. Kamen Khan. Now, under the chapter of earnestly addressing people's livelihood concern, land and housing are the priority. Now, this is not a new idea created by this term of the government, but I do see the determination shown by this government. Like the Secretary said, it is an innovative measure to publicize the land forecast for the next 10 years. And also the government is taking initiative in publicizing its land creation strategies. So it will serve to stabilize housing price and also people's the market sentiment. Now, there are more than 110 indicators in the annex of the PA. The CE has mentioned about infrastructure-led development approach, but it is not among the 110 indicators. So may the Secretary supplement on how the infrastructure-led approach would be adopted. On enhancing speed and efficiency, a bill would be introduced into five bills will be introduced into Legco by the end of this year, or by the Development Bureau. So what about the scheduled, what about the targeted passage of the bills? Well, if you have such a timetable of a passage of the bills, we can work together with you to make that happen, because we can afford no more delays. If you want to shorten the development schedule from 13 years to 7 years and so on, we will have to pick up speed. Secretary, thank you. In terms of the infrastructure-led approach, the PA has the highlights of the PA would be the six new major routes and railways. They are compatible and complementary with our strategic layout of the development. That's why we have to make ahead. We have to make a planning for the Trianglonal Area 137 sites for the development of the major railways and routes. Now for the five bills, we are looking to introduce the bills into legislation by the end of this year. We hope that the bills will be passed as soon as possible. And of course, we will come to the panels and brief our members on the measures. Once that happens, we can realize quicker timetable from primitive sites to space-ready sites. But for individual projects, it really depends on the stage of the projects. If it is at a preliminary planning stage, then after the passage of the bill, we can adopt the streamlined procedures. If the EIA is yet to be done, after the passage of the bill, the streamlined EIA requirements will apply. So I support the Secretary's approach. The amended legislation and the amended requirements shouldn't just apply to future projects, but also existing projects as well. So this is a Development Bureau-led measure. Will the Development Bureau also be the one to brief us at the panel stage? Yes, I believe so. Before I invite Mr. Frank Yeh to speak, I would like to read out the remaining members' names. They have they've indicated that they would like to speak. We have Ms. Lee Jen Kern, Dr. Wendy Hong, Ms. Chen Yu Ming, Mr. Andrew Lam, Ms. Lam So Wai, Mr. Stanley Ng, Stephen Ho, Elizabeth Quartz, Mr. Dennis Leung, and Mr. Louis Leung. Mr. Frank Yeh. Thank you, Chair. Concerning the item 3D on the major land creation measures, development of brownfield sites, more than 1,600 hectares will be resumed for housing purposes and other purposes. I would like to make it clear to the Secretary that there are indeed economic activities ongoing on brownfield sites. They are not the so-called destroyed sites. Now you said you would ensure that there will be sites available. There will be sites leased to affected brownfield sites operators at a rent less under the market price. So I appreciate this measure. But we have to ensure seamless transition because you can't ask the brownfield sites operators to close their business for a few years. So it seems that you have already come up with a list of available sites for relocating the brownfield sites operators. So I hope you can do it quickly. This list shows that nine departments have adverse comments on such sites for relocating the brownfield sites operators. So I hope that you can give us more choice and facilitate the entire process to help the brownfield sites operators. On the GFA concession for car parks, you didn't give us more details on this. Now you would give a GFA concession or for private developers if the car parks are placed underground, but it is very costly to put them underground. So I hope that I welcome the idea of allowing GFA concession for car parks above ground. We have a serious shortage of car parking spaces, especially for commercial vehicles. The shortage is 1 to 0.6. So at another occasion, I told this administration that because of the closed borders, 3,000 commercial vehicles are stranded in Hong Kong. So there's no way to park them, and they are parking on the streets, and then a fixed penalty and tickets are issued. So I hope the secretary can offer some temporary sites for temporary parking until the borders is reopened. So on the Round Island Trail, we welcome the idea. Now under the sports and leisure item 7, the seaside promenade by year 2030, and you would extend the length of the promenade by 30%. It is a cause for concern for the industry. I hope you won't I hope you won't take away the warehouse loading and unloading area in Hong Kong. We do have some major warehouses in Yamate and Kwai Chung and also Kwun Tong. If you take away the land, it would deal a huge blow to the logistics industry. Now, the Maritime Department has conducted a study. The finding is that these warehouses are valuable to livelihood. So I hope you would keep this in mind when developing the promenade corridor. Thank you. On brownfield sites, we don't have the intention to take away all the brownfield sites operations. So there is 8,000 hectares brownfield sites made available for developments. That is already a very sizable area. The brownfield sites do have ongoing operations. Well, for those vacant brownfield sites, it is also useful because it can be used for relocating the existing operators. We are aware that many brownfield site operators require operation in open space, and they cannot be moved to multi-story industrial buildings. So the planning department would be responsible for reaching out to the brownfield site operators and also liaise with the town planning board on the most contentious sites. So on the items to be followed up, there will be an item on creating a position of a directorate post for handling brownfield site operations. In terms of car parks, only underground car parks will enjoy 100% GFA concession. For at grade car park, of course, we certainly don't want to see every car park being moved above ground simply because of the cost. But we may set some standards that certain GFA concessions that would be offered to car parks partially above ground and partially underground. And also we would consider the impacts of the car parks on the aesthetics of the neighborhood. By middle next year, we will have the proposals ready. In terms of connecting the promenade, it will not involve major changes to the loading and unloading area, and there will be mitigation measures if they are indeed impacted. Mr. Lee Tsz-king. Thank you, Chair. I do see the government's resolution and determination in identifying land. Now, we'd like to talk about land reserves. The Liberal Party supports building up land reserves under a multi-pronged approach. I'm happy that the government has taken on board our suggestions. Now, because of the because there is an income limit for PRH applicants, for many applicants, they would avoid getting high-paid jobs or even refusing a pay rise because they want to be eligible for a PRH. So I hope the government can be more flexible. For example, building public housing unit, public housing estates for people with higher income or the sandwich class. And also, we should balance the OSH.
Now, the second point, a question for the government. There are fringe areas in country parks. They are left out in the policy address. In Tai Lam Country Park, for example, can the government make use of the area? It's not a particularly ecologically important site, not exactly great value for public enjoyment. Can you build public housing there for non-profit making? You can add that to your land reserve. The third point, it has to do with the environmental impact assessment. During development projects, you have groups applying for judicial review over EIA. So for the Northern Metropolis, how long do you expect to take? That is, how long do you expect possible appeals or JR cases to take? The member mentioned land reserve. With more land reserve, we have more room to come up with policies. As for the housing ladder, under the current policy, there is no plan to make changes to housing ladder. But if we have more land, then we would certainly be a better position to improve living environment for people. Now, turning to the fringe areas of country parks, since we are on this drive to develop land, are we going to explore country parks? Well, we have never ruled out the fringe areas of country parks as a source of land supply, but it's really a matter of priority. Now, for the 200 odd hectares of greenbelt sites, we are making a proposal, but there is much work that remains ahead. If we want to turn the 200 plus hectares of greenbelt sites into spade-ready sites, we have to kickstart the engineering studies right away. We all have to go through the town planning procedure. So we cannot provide a concrete timetable as to when we can look at the fringe areas of individual country parks, but we are not ruling out this possibility. I want to stress a point here. By fringe areas of country parks, we're not saying that the government will be developing country parks. This is just not the case. Instead, what we're saying is that we're looking at fringe areas, individual areas of particular country parks. This would be something highly specific. We're not exploring every single country park. That wouldn't be unrealistic. So just to clarify this point. Next, Dr. Wendy Hong. Secretary, I have several questions about brownfield operators with the Northern Metropolis development. Brownfield operators will be affected. That is, they have to be relocated. There are news reports about brownfield operators in Kwutong North, Fanning North, Wang Chau, Tuen Mun. There are at least 10 brownfield operators that are facing imminent land resumption, or the land has already been resumed. Ice blocks, for example, is just one example. What do you make of these brownfield operators that are rural industries? For our reindustrialization drive, we need land development. In the short term, medium and long term, what kinds of land can be used for industrial development? These operators need to know how long they can occupy the land for before they can proceed with plans. We also need industrial plans. What are our priority areas? Advanced manufacturing, maybe. Are we going to phase out other industries, highly polluting industries, for example? What kind of industry can be left alone and develop on their own? What kinds of industry will require upgrading and transformation? Ice blocks are needed. It's by no means an advanced manufacturing industry. It makes no sense for us to import outside ice blocks. So we need to leave these ice block manufacturers alone. Let them go on. We need to let the stakeholders understand whether there is still room for their industry to develop, and they can plan for the future. So a few questions from me. In terms of relocating brownfield operators, will the Development Bureau be working with the Industry Innovation Technology and Industry Bureau to come with a blueprint so that brownfield operators will know whether they will be phased out and they can see whether there's room for them? And in terms of relocation, some brownfield operators want to be relocated to multi-story industrial buildings. Now, there was a study about the brownfield operations in the new territories. Just 10% of the brownfield operators believed they could be relocated to an industrial building. What's the take of the Development Bureau? What's the percentage of brownfield operators that can be accommodated in industrial buildings? Now, brownfield operators need a place where they can have long-term development before they will actually undertake long-term development. If you give them a lease of 2 to 3 years, they make very limited investment and resort to rudimentary ways of operation. In Singapore, for example, in terms of relocating industries, they get 20-year leases. Will Hong Kong learn from Singapore's example by offering longer leases for relocated operators? Will you be giving brownfield operators, would landowners be given incentives so that they can offer longer leases for brownfield operators? Secretary, please. Dr. Hong touched on a wide variety of matters. Now, for the affected brownfield operators, they encompass a wide range of operators. Maybe Dr. Hong had something very high value adding in mind, something that required investment. But other brownfield operators require just mobility instead of a large amount of investment. Some brownfield operators need to run their business on the plot of land they actually own. So when they vacate their site, they will need compensation in terms of a land lot. Other brownfield operators told us that they are renting their land lot. Their lease may be 3 years to 4 years in duration, and that's the case that remains today. So we are talking about a variety of brownfield operators in different circumstances. So are we depriving brownfield operators of a place where they can have long-term operations by resuming their land? That's not the case. Some brownfield operators are already operating on short leases. So we have to take a multi-pronged approach. Some brownfield operators may be able to secure a place for their operations. We are looking at the huge area when we are talking about the new territories. There may be helpful information to help these operators to reach their goal. Some operations are vital for Hong Kong's operation. So we should make a greater effort to make sure these brownfield operators can relocate to another site without interruption to their operations. These may be some high value adding operations. That's why we need to set up a dedicated unit to look at the brownfield operators case by case. Members, we have 36 minutes or so before we have to conclude our meeting. 8 members have yet to speak. I will have to be strict with enforcing a time limit. We cannot extend the meeting because there will be another meeting in this meeting room. So when you hit the 4-minute mark, I will stop you. If the secretary cannot get to your question, I will leave some time to the secretary. I hope you can understand. Next, Ms. Chen Yunming. I thank the secretary for her presentation. I have two questions. First, the policy address touched on the land supply for the next 10 years. That will be 3,280 hectares. Now, the paper said 1,300 hectares will come from the northern metropolis. In 2023, all the way to 2024, for places like Macho Long, Law Woman, Kemto, the North, New Territories, New Town, there will be new development projects. So for the next 10 years, the 1,300 hectares of land from the north within the metropolis, will the land cover those from places like Taku Lang, etc.? The policy address also makes reference to greater use of the modular integrated construction. There will also be MIC chain measures. There will be places for the sector to manufacture and store the modules. But we don't have the locations. Can the secretary tell us where will be the locations? Where will be the site for these MIC modules? When will the production base commence operation? Chair, in terms of the supply of space-ready sites over the next 10 years, some will come from northern New Territories, like Taku Lang. Now, things will kickstart earlier with the Sha Tin Technopole. In the northeast of New Territories, the projects will start one after another. Now, in terms of a part in the northern metropolis specifically dedicated to the use as a base for MIC modules, we don't have a specific location in mind, but we are exploring this matter in our study. Any follow-up question from you, Ms. Chen? Next, Mr. Andrew Lam. Thank you, Chair. I wish to make two points. I support setting up a land reserve. Apart from the large projects like the Northern Metropolis and the Cao Yichao Reclamation, Greenbelt site represents another key area as covered by the policy address. More than 6,000 hectares of land are land without restrictions on what you can do with them. Next year, the government will look at what to do with the land. Now, the policy address also mentions priority areas for agricultural activities. Will the relevant study be completed next year? For the more than 6,000 hectares of greenbelt sites, not all of that land is suitable for high-density development. This was made clear by the secretary. I am pleased to hear that the land can be used for other kinds of development, for other industries. Can you use the land for reprovisioning agricultural facilities for agricultural purposes? So when we talk about land reserve, the land is not just for housing. We should have a table setting out all the possibilities that for a land reserve. My second point regarding streamlining procedures, I applaud what the government is doing, especially the buildings department's dedicated unit. It's a good sign to see that the dedicated unit will become a facilitator in the process. In terms of modifying land leases and approval processes, all these processes take a long time. Apart from the buildings department, will the lands department also be functioning as a facilitator through a dedicated processing unit? Secretary, please. Now, regarding the study of an agricultural priority area, now we have the Agricultural Fisheries and Conservation Department and other departments working together on this. We're trying to get the study completed within next year. these departments that are the departments involved, they look at all these different overlapping work in terms of greenbelt sites possibly being used for agricultural purposes. Now, turning to streamlining procedures, at the buildings department, they look at development projects involving those involving 500 units or more. For the lands department, they kickstarted something similar early on. So the lands department took the lead, and now we're moving on to the buildings department. At the Development Bureau, we also have a project enhancement office. The office is tasked with looking at the large-scale property enhanced property development. The office, that is the project facilitation office, looks at the project. We have specific contact points in the process. So the initiative has been working.
Ms. Connie Lam, Chair. Alleviating the housing problem is the government's key objective. The PA and the CE will kickstart the commencement of constructing the Chengkwano area, 135 area. There will be some 200,000 population in the area. So on behalf of the Chengkwano area residents, now, there will be reclamation projects on the waters of the Chengkwano Inno Park and the cemetery. Now, the 137 area will there will be ancillary supporting facilities in terms of social welfare facilities and traffic transport to support the area 137. Now, infrastructure-led principle is very important, but I receive a lot of inquiries from Chengkwano residents. Some of them object to the reclamation projects of the Lotus Park area because it would affect the environment, air quality, and even the property price of Lotus Park. So what is the plan? Originally, in year 2013, the government proposed reclamation projects of the industrial estate, but it was put on hold because of the resistance from the residents. Now, the government is refloating the plan. Will the government consider conducting reclamation at other areas to support the Area 137? Chair, in terms of land development, each project, there are no projects that would go without any resistance. As the member has said, once we propose the nearshore reclamation of Area 137, immediately, residents in the neighborhood raised a concern. So we do have some reassurances for the residents there. High-density development will be placed at Area 137. That is the 500 housing yield will be at Area 137. But we do need supporting facilities. For example, the Chengkwano line extension. To facilitate the alignment, land has to be made available. If the alignment cuts across the area 137, it would affect the housing yield of the area. On the other hand, if the alignment or if reclamation projects are conducted off at the Lotus Park to support a part of the alignment, then we can achieve the maximum housing yield from area 137, while public space and low-density community facilities that can be offered on the reclaimed land. We do appreciate the residents' concern about affecting the landscape and so on. But by the end of this year, when we have a more detailed plan, we would consult the residents, and residents will have ample opportunities to raise the views. But I urge residents look at the bigger picture. A follow-up question, Chair. Secretary, prior to the report by the end of this year, would you go to Changguanuo and listen to the residents' concerns? Well, we hope the directions offered in the paper today would give some assurances and some preliminary ideas to the residents concerning the detailed and in-depth consultation. That would be the end of this year. Otherwise, we would fall into the trap, and we would be caught in the same loop. A repeated consultation would not help in terms of streamlining procedures. So Mr. Edward Leung has just pressed the button requesting to speak as well. Now the meeting will be adjourned at 4:30. If there is still time, I would allow Mr. Edward Leung to speak. Otherwise, you can submit your questions in written form to the administration, and I can help facilitate that. Thank you. Next, Mr. Stanley Ng. Thank you, Chair. I'm pleased to see the government has accepted the FTU's proposal to create and identify a land with a multi-pronged approach. There has been a lot of discussion on building up land reserve. Well, strictly speaking, it is not about land reserve. The government strategy is to tie in with the future housing and development's need. That's why land is needed. The government strategy is to satisfy the land demand for the next 10 years. But right now, we don't have any land on hand. Well, the government can say that every inch of land in Hong Kong belongs to the government's belongs in the government's custody, but that's not the reality. There is a saying in the mainland that with some reserve, you won't panic. Oh, but the government doesn't have any land reserve on hand for future development. Hong Kong's development is greatly constrained by the availability of land. Without an indicative target of land created each year for different types of development, there is no way to realize all the development potentials. So I think the government should adjust its policies and make reference to Shenzhen. In Shenzhen, more than 80 to 90% of land is developed. But still, the government has set a standard or an indicator in terms of land planning. And I also have a question concerning developments along the railway, that is the Island North extension. It seems that the project has been scrapped. Now there will be 6 new major routes and railways to tie in with the developments in the northern metropolis. And the government also has said that the Changguanuo Area 137 would be developed. Counting the population in the area, there is really justification to build the Hong Kong, the Island and North extension. Why is the government abandoning the plan? Chair, on the Island North extension question, this should be under the purview of the Transport and Logistics Bureau. The TLB is conducting the study on major routes and railway. I believe that a holistic blueprint is on the way. On setting our own land planning indicator, that is land creation target within a certain period of time. Well, I believe that the 10-year forecast is something along the line. In some way, it is an indicator. Well, if we have to set a target to create a certain quantity of land each year or in certain years, well, we have to do it step by step. I've also asked the media has asked the government this question: how much land reserves is sufficient? Well, I urge the public to stop debating on this question on how much is enough. Instead, we should look at the projects down the pipeline. A lot of land is required. So we are trying to create a land supply beyond the estimated demand under the 2030-plus projects. It would be a great start. Mr. Stephen Ho, now just now Mr. Ng said we have to have land available for us to be able to develop. Now, the quantity of agricultural land is dwindling in Hong Kong. Now, I don't think the Environment and Ecology Bureau is the main player in this regard. There is the Sustainable Development Blueprint, and then the Development Bureau is developing land. So when the EEB has the blueprints available, the land is already developed. Now previously, there was an issue about relocating a pig farm. I'm still following up on the issue. So what about the blueprints? What about the future plan for relocating farms? The industry is very worried. Now, the government has yet to make a response concerning the Yunlong South pig farm incident. So every day, farmers are very worried. So what is the role of the Environment and Ecology Bureau in Northern Metropolis development? So if the Development Bureau is taking the lead, then the Ecology Bureau will have no role to play. Now, even before the AFCD has completed the agricultural blueprint, the policy address is already taking away the land available. There are reclamation everywhere, Cheung Kwan Lo Area 137, KYC Artificial Island, and so on. There is no compensation policy or relocation policies on the table yet. So I don't know how you are going to compensate the farmers in new territories. So at least you have to show some sincerity and give the farmers some plans. Now, the concerning the compensation policies, you only mentioned the 2018 compensation made to squatters, dwellers, and also so on, but you never mentioned any compensation for farmers. For every chicken, you will pay the farmers $30, and for a well, another sum. Well, you have to ensure that the farm owners have the fund to rebuild their operations. It costs $200 million to set up a farm. So I know the secretary is not in the position to answer me, but anyway. Chair, under the Yunlong South project, when securing member support, we have promised to identify sites to relocate the pig and poultry farm uses and make compensation. We haven't stopped our efforts. We are responsible for identifying the sites for reprovisioning the operations, and the Environment and Ecology Bureau is responsible for telling us that the operational standards for these farms. What facilities do they need, and how far should they be away from other uses? My apologies, because of our work in preparing the policy address, and there was no time for us to get back to Mr. Stephen Ho. I promise my bureau and the other bureau will reach back to you soon. Now, on compensation to farmers and livestock farmers, true, it is not mentioned in the policy address. Most of the compensation involved compensations to squatter dwellers and others. For farmers, they were mainly relocated to the agri-park and so on. In terms of compensation, we have begun the reviewing work with the support of the AFCD. So there have been some communication between us already.
Chair,
there's a problem with this attitude. For those disadvantaged, they're always the disadvantaged. They are at best an afterthought. The Central People's Government said that deep-seated tensions need to be resolved. So, Chair, something needs to be done. So something needs to be done with communication and execution. Next, Ms. Elizabeth Kwot. I hope the government and the Development Bureau in particular can attach greater importance to the Agriculture and Fisheries Department, because they feel like they are being treated as an afterthought at best. Now, I welcome the government's proposal to enhance speed, quantity, efficiency, and etc. My question is this. We need more housing units. Will the government increase the plot ratio for residential buildings so that we can have more buildings in the short term? Second question, speeding up the approval of building plans. Apart from housing units, you also need to do something about elderly care homes. There are building plans. The plans are being passed between different departments, but the approval remains elusive. So can you expedite things in approving building plans for elderly care homes? As President Xi also mentioned, we need to care for our elderly. My third point is that while I support the wider use of technology, MIC, for example, and BIM, I was pleased to hear that the Secretary pledged wider use of the technology. There are also new technologies that you can make wider use of. With the CSDI, the Common Spatial Data Infrastructure, we have a CGISP. We have this Common Geospatial Data Infrastructure. With this application, you can speed up the time, speed up the process of identifying sites for development. Now, for the North Metropolis and the reclamation projects, you will pick up the pace, and I'm pleased to see that. We want to see a smart city. When it comes to planning and infrastructure for a smart city, you need to get started early. I hope, Secretary, you can give us proposals in terms of how you can turn the Northern Metropolis into a smart city. The member has raised a number of questions. First, the point about plot ratio. On Hong Kong Island, as well as in urban areas of Kowloon, we have higher plot ratios. It's 7.5 for domestic plot ratios in Kowloon. It's 8 to 10 when you look at the same domestic plot ratio on Hong Kong Island. But for the new territories in Kau Yi Chau, now we have to make the environment livable. These are new towns. Now, we don't want to have buildings as dense as what you see in urban areas, but we don't want the plot ratio to be as low as 3 or 4 in the rural areas. So for the policy address, it stated that for the Northern Metropolis, the domestic plot ratio will be set at 6.5 as an indicator. But that doesn't mean that 6.5 will be the uniform plot ratio across the board in every part of the Northern Metropolis. But overall, for the new generation of new towns in Cao Yi Chao or other parts of the new territories, we want to take 6.5 as the indicative plot ratio for residential buildings. I'll come to the point about elderly care homes. We are trying different things to boost the supply of elderly care homes. And we will have social welfare buildings on government land. On public housing estates, we set aside a certain floor area for social welfare facilities, elderly care homes being one example. In the policy address, the chief executive has asked the Development Bureau and the Labor and Welfare Bureau to encourage developers to provide floor area for elderly care homes. Now, what do we mean by encouraging developers to do so? It will probably involve something like concessions in terms of floor area and concessions in terms of land premium. We hope that we can give you a more concrete plan in early next year so that private developers can also contribute to this end. Now, turning to the point about developing a smart city. For our new generation of development areas, Northern Metropolis or Cao Yi Chao, a smart city will be a key direction for us, and there will be a lot of work going towards this end. Next, Mr. Dennis Leung.
Thank you, Chair. The government pledged massive investments in infrastructure. The problem is that we have so many infrastructure projects, but we have a shortage of construction workers to work on all these projects. My concern is that there is talk about importing workers, and that ends up dragging down the wages for our local workers. What can the government do about this problem? We have to face up to this problem. We have a shortage of workers, and then we have to import workers. What can we do to make sure everything works out? Now, turning to the Northern Metropolis and the Cao Yi Chao Artificial Island, priority will go to infrastructure. Can the government set aside more space for livelihood community facilities such as markets? The government needs to have a plan. For each major area, you may need 2 to 3 public markets instead of just one to meet the people's needs. There's also something about heritage preservation. Now, there is something, we have monuments in Hong Kong from the anti-Japanese warfare. The government should include these monuments, heritage, into their national education. The government can play a more proactive role in this. The secretary. Workers are concerned about any proposal of importing construction workers. We have imported workers. We have to do this with moderation, with justification as well. When we have more construction projects, there will be more pressure for having imported workers. Of course, things are not as simple as getting imported workers the moment you find a worker shortage. We can make use of advanced technology, such as modular integrated construction. There are also other technologies available. We can also train up our local population, get more local people to join the construction industry, and then we look at the shortage. So we do things in moderation and with justification. In the process, we will remain in touch with the local workers. Now, turning to monuments, heritage buildings. Now, can we make them fit into our national education? Now, something similar will be done in November. Now, there will be a forum on historic buildings. Mainland experts and scholars will join us at the forum. We will have a discussion about this area and make good use of these resources. Next, Mr. Lewis Long.
Thank you, Chair. I have just one question. It's about streamlining the procedure for renewing land leases. Secretary, the government will submit a bill next year. Can you tell us what will the arrangement be like? Will land premium need to be paid? Or will government rent be charged instead?
I thank the member for giving me an opportunity to clarify this point. Land lease, it's a sensitive topic in Hong Kong. We are not changing our policy regarding land leases. Since the handover, more than 20 land leases expired, except one or two cases where we couldn't get hold of the leaseholder. We renewed the leases for the remaining cases. No additional land premium was charged. They just have to pay 3% of the rateable value. That's the amount they had to pay. This policy will remain in place. Now, why are we bringing up the legislation? We have to streamline the procedure. In the past, even when the government agreed to an extension for another 50 years for a land lease, that is, general land leases for residential or commercial buildings. But land leases, being a contract, require a signed document between the lands department and every single party involved, and then these people, each of them, have to enter into contracts with banks. So that creates a lot of hassle. That's why we have come to this proposal. A few years before the time a lease expires, the government gazettes a notice setting out the land leases due to expire within the same year, and that is, unless there's any notice to the contrary, all such land leases will be renewed. So no more signature is required. That is something we hope we can bring the bill to the electrical next year. Before the handover, when some land leases expired in the new territories, we adopted similar practices.
Last question from Mr. Edward Leung. You will have 2 minutes.
Thank you, Chair.
For Area 137 of Tsuen Kwan O, there will be 50,000 housing units. Now, if we are talking about families of three, that will be 150,000 people. And then you also have the Lohas Park. And then you also have a Tsuen Kwan O industrial estate. There will be a lot of traffic, a lot of people. Now, I know traffic will be outside your bureau's purview. But then with an expansion in the local population, and you have the East Cross Harbour Tunnel, and then you have the existing rail link, there will be tremendous pressure on the existing transportation infrastructure. Has your bureau got in touch with the transport authorities over things like, can we have, say, another Cross Harbour Tunnel? Can we have a further extension of the MTR link leading all the way to Siu Sai Wan to take pressure off the transportation system? Secretary, you may have to take this proposal to the Transport and Logistics Bureau. And I believe they may be noting members' comments as someone has already proposed this possibility. So you have talked about the pressure on the transport system. Have you discussed ways to take pressure off the transport network?
Now, we haven't come to the point of extending the rail link across the Victoria Harbour. But as for the full plan, the Transport and Logistics Bureau is compiling the 2030 plus plan regarding the transport link, and they will have a fuller picture to present. Now, we will wrap up the discussion here. Agenda item number 4, any other business? Now, there being no other business, I declare that this meeting is adjourned.